You couldn't help but being inspired, like to want to play and to play well. Yeah.
Ticket holders, tickets, all got tickets.
The ground and the club are special to me because, very simply, the memories stay forever.
You can see the crowds flocking in there and the place absolutely jumping, everyone's singing Bubbles.
I've played all round the country and all round the world, and they're the greatest bunch of fans I know.
It's part of my life. You know, I spent 19 years playing for the club I supported.
A word that I would use is probably soul.
When you play for West Ham, it is the best place on earth to play football.
It's a fantastic, fantastic club. And I don't know really what to say.
It's great coming back. It's always been somewhere that's always been close to my heart. It was dreamland, really.
If you give your best on the field, they're gonna remember you for many years to come.
I love the place. I know everyone here, obviously. And I've never really wanted to play for anyone else.
I spent a very happy time at West Ham. It was a lovely club. I met some very special people, especially my wife. My wife's name was Anne Sheridan. She had the name of a film star, and I thought she was a film star at the time anyway. And we're still together, thank goodness, and hope it'll go on for a long time more. They gave me £3 a week and £1 for a win and 10 shillings for a draw. And it was shortly after the war. Rationing was still in place at the time. I wasn't in the first team at the time, and I went down to watch it after my supper and my digs. I was in digs at the time. And I just got down to the gate and someone dragged me in and said, "You're playing." And I said, "Ah." I just had my supper, never mind, and said, "You're playing." So I played against Arsenal, and I had a good game, apparently. Upton Park was a big stadium to me because I come from Ireland, a small stadium, no big stand. And to play in front of a full house at Upton Park was a great experience. The atmosphere was great.
West Ham, however, also had ideas about the cup, and they were two up when O'Farrell got the ball past Farn.
It was amusing to have the far side of ground called the Chicken Run. And there used to be an old chap who stood on the halfway line at during matches. And every time the opposition was attacking, he'd shout, "Shut the gate," you know, and this Cockney accent. And they had a problem with me as well because of a broad Irish accent, and they found it difficult to understand me. So we had a mutual sort of problem.
First thing that comes to mind, not playing, it's painting the stand in the off-season. Coming home with my girlfriend saying I had more paint in my hair than finished up on stands here.
We went in and we had to work all summer. And so we're painting the crash barriers that people leaned on, painting them claret and blue, cleaning out the old Chicken Run, you know, that was full up with rubbish and waste and money and all sorts used to fall through the slats here, you know. Well, you always found a few quid there, you know, probably more than we were earning a week. You'd find a few coins, and if you're lucky, you might find a £5 note or something, you know.
Standing room that side.
Get your jackpot ticket, 6%.
When I came as a youngster, or late 50s it was, back in those days you could come with your dad, and brother was a bit bigger and taller than me, and I sort of let us go down the front. Sometimes you brought a little stall in, believe it, and also you could stand on the stall and see the pitch a bit better.
I left school just before my 15th birthday, and sort of grew up in the East End of London anyway, and Upton Park was only a bus ride from me. I lived in Poplar. So getting on the bus, going training every morning, stopping at a little cafe. We used to meet in a cafe or go round. Cazatari's was round the corner. We used to go to Caz's and sit in there all afternoon talking about football or listening to the senior players talking about football.
We used to talk tactics, moving the tomato sauce bottle and the vinegar bottle on the table with the players. In fact, my wife always knew I'd been there because I came home smelling of eggs and bacon.
I'm sitting here talking to you now. I can see Paddy O'Leary, the one of the groundsmen. Paddy lived in the ground, you know. That was him, just three of them. They had a lawnmower, they cut the grass. There wasn't hundreds of groundsmen like there are now and all out there digging the pitch at half time. The pitch was like a mud heap within, you know, 8 weeks of the season starting. The band used to stand by the dugout as you come out. They'd stand there stamping their feet playing. And by after 4 weeks of the season, there wasn't a bit of grass, about a 40-yard, 30-yard area, where the band had just stood there and wore all the grass out.
Rolling the pitch when it was very muddy, you had to roll it quite quickly because if it froze over, you wouldn't be able to play for another couple of weeks because there'd be jagged edges of mud sticking up.
We had a bad winter one year and we spent 5 or 6 weeks training out in the car park every day. You know, the grounds were all snowed under. We used to have to clear the car park off of snow. And we'd go out and all the punters would be peering through by behind the gates at the front. And we'd be training on that forecourt with our plimsolls on. And then if not, we'd be running up and down the terracing. Every day we'd be out on that forecourt playing and having great games. 8 a-sides, you know, the first team would train first, then the reserves, then the youth team. I think by the time we'd finished, the youth team or whatever, we're getting the bath from the first lot still. You know, you're all jumping in a dirty bath. I mean, you can't comprehend it now, but no one seemed to bother in them days. It was a great atmosphere because we were all kids from the same area, all from the same backgrounds. We all came within 4 or 5 miles of West Ham's football ground. They never had to buy a player, West Ham. It was just a conveyor belt of kids from that part of London. The manager, Ron Greenwood, didn't have to go into a transfer market. Fantastic manager, Ron Greenwood. We all learnt the game off of him.
This is what the game's all about. The people come into turnstiles and they want to see a game of entertainment.
We used to train up and down the track here with spikes. It was a regular feature of not only this club but other clubs where you had a day for sprinting with spikes. And the first thing Ron did when he came was to throw them out. And we all thought, whoa, what the hell, this is a revolution, what's going on? And they had this fantastic idea where you train in football boots, which was rather remarkable when you think. Amazing.
My first year there as a 15-year-old, we won the FA Youth Cup. You know, we were getting crowds of 18, 20,000 people to watch the youth team play. One thing that always sticks in my mind was the FA Youth Cup semi-final, Wolverhampton. For some reason, it was played on a Saturday afternoon at Molyneux, and he came with the youth team rather than going with the first team, which was incredible. I remember training one day, and we're out there till about 4:30, 4:45 in the afternoon. Old Ernie, Greg Ernie, was great character, you know, but he said, come on, that's enough, off you go, get in, you know. I think Ernie wanted to go out for his dinner, and Ron Greenwood said, as long as they want to stay out there, I don't care they can stay out till 8 o'clock at night, as long as they're doing something useful.
I wasn't a big star, nobody was chasing me as a kid, and he simply took me, a struggling, mediocre midfield player, transformed me by placing me up front. What made him was a fantastic coach.
He was so forward thinking. On another level, I've never met anybody as good as him, even to this day, who could come anywhere near him in terms of his knowledge and his coaching ability. He was fantastic.
So to Wembley for the grand finale of the soccer season. Wilson takes it, Jeff Hurst shoots on the rebound, and Kelly just fails to save. Well done, Hammers. Right on the nail.
There'd have been great times for the club, not because I was there. There'd have been great times for the club anyway with Ron Greenwood turning up.
The pass from Boyce went to Seeley. This time it really was a goal. The whole country is proud of the Hammers.
That's almost the starting point for anyone of my generation, that transition from second division, and then by the middle of the next decade, we had won the FA Cup, Cup Winners' Cup, and were involved as key individuals, players, you know, with winning the World Cup. So it was a fantastic time to be associated with West Ham.
A new soccer season for this West Ham United versus Chelsea match.
a big crowd, a shirt-sleeved crowd. In fact, many places, a shirtless crowd.
Here we are finishing the World Cup on the 30th of July. Within about 4 or 5 days, we were back at the club. There was no month off like we see today.
And here come the three World Cup players coming out on the road. Bobby Moore, 5. Number 10, Jeff Hurst, the man who got the hat-trick. Number 4, Martin Peters. And the Chelsea players stand and applaud the three great stars of West Ham United and England, the world champions.
I signed from Charlton, and obviously Charlton were a low second division side in those days to play with the likes of Bobby Moore and Martin Peters and Jeff Hurst. It was, you know, intimidating to come here.
You know, when I first got in a starting 11, I might quickly pass the ball on to them rather than do something with themselves. So it probably took me a little time then to settle in.
It's a corner to West Ham. Brooking. And Peters!
You had to wait your time. I even asked for a transfer list at one stage.
Brooking pulled down. Trevor Brooking pulled down. Of course, he takes a fair bit of stick. Pulled down there by Watson.
Here at West Ham, we are very lucky to have such a player as Jeffrey Hurst.
To Hurst. Look at Hurst, beautiful poise and balance by this big man. Courage and strength are his greatest assets, but he's added so much control to that.
My nickname here was Puffer, because every time I exploded a shot, my cheeks puffed out. Playing Sunderland and scoring 6 goals hasn't been done since in a game. Scoring 3 in both halves. Double hat-trick on a personal basis is naturally the highlight of my footballing career. The cross from Harry Redknapp, first goal, near post, and I couldn't quite get to it, and I sort of half flicked it. I'm not sure how much by my hand, but afterwards, not being a cheat, I owned up to the fact that I sort of half flicked the one in, and got home on a Sunday and saw my parents, and my dad said, "You've scored 6 goals," he said, "which is absolutely, probably never be beaten again." He said, "There's more fuss about you owning up to the handball than anything else." I said, "Well, Dad, I have to be honest, you know, I'm not a cheat, and I did, you got to own up, unlike Maradona, to say it was in."
Bobby Moore, in footballing terms, is a genius. Not only Bobby's defensive qualities, but also his ability to detach himself from a game, observe, exploit, and correct on behalf of his team.
As you come in the dressing room, Bobby would get changed just halfway up on the right-hand side. Bob would always put his shorts on last. He'd stand by the door with his shorts in his hand.
Bobby was the same age as me, probably 8 or 9 months older. My hero was Bobby Moore.
Durbin, on for O'Hare. Bobby Moore winning it again.
If you'd have gone to watch him play, you'd have said, well, no, he's got no pace, not great in the air, not particularly big for a central defender, but just read the game.
Internationally, we've had nobody close to him at the back.
Everybody just idolised him. I don't think I've never met anybody who's ever come in contact with him who didn't absolutely love him. There wasn't a bad bone in him. He was just a fantastic footballer.
Oh, sticking out that very experienced foot to turn it away into touch.
Now Bobby Moore. They've got to go for Moore soon. A shot down!
He was every kid's dream, wasn't he, really? He was this boy, you know, grew up to be captain England to win the World Cup at Wembley. Great captain of West Ham. He was a most incredible footballer. They were great times, great days.
Fans took to me straight away. They were always great with me, the fans. You know, in those days, you had all the pubs and the docks all around the East End of London, and they were tough old boys, some of them. And I think they appreciated somebody who gave 100%, and got his foot in a little bit, you know, but I did stick my foot in a bit, and I think they appreciated that in a player.
Best jumping well for him. Billy Bonds. Oh, a goal by Bonds, and a beauty. And good evening from Upton Park. What a night in prospect. With the West Germans leading 2-1 after the first leg in Frankfurt a fortnight ago. Can men like Trevor Brooking create enough in midfield to see West Ham through to Brussels and the final next month?
At home, when the place was absolutely rocking, you know, we won 3-1. I scored a couple of goals, which helps.
Chipped in again towards Brooking. And it's there! Brooking has done it! Taylor. Brooking! Beautiful timing! Still Brooking! Yes! Number three! Magnificent!
They saw us over the line, the crowd, and that's what they can do for you, this crowd, when they're really up for it.
Trevor Brooking scored the two goals, one with his head and one with his foot.
Everyone thinks the 1980 Cup Final one was the only heady goal I ever scored in my career. I used to get one a season, honest.
The Hammers have done it again.
I arrived here 2 months after the great Bobby Moore had left to go to Fulham. And Billy Bonds had taken over from Bobby Moore as captain. And I was so aware how important the captaincy was at that time. Two fabulous players. How do you follow Bobby Moore and Billy Bonds? I think I'd played about 30, 40 games. A young player, and I went to clear a ball and Billy Bonds tried to head it at the same time.
And all I saw was a great big size 12 coming towards me, and it caught me under the eye and right down the bridge of the nose.
And I think I must have slit his eye from here down to here with a big cut here on his head, and he went down on the floor, blood everywhere.
I had a plaster down my nose, I had my plaster across my eye, and this is before I went to hospital and had the stitches.
And I remember thinking, what have I just done? You know, I've just totally taken out my own player and one of the gods of West Ham. Billy had to go off, which was unlike Bill.
He said I was carried off on a stretcher as well, I believe, didn't he? Well, I would never have been carried off in a stretcher. I would have always got off the pitch myself. Funnily enough, it wasn't that painful, if you know what I mean. Centre halves got broken noses and they got split eyes, and that was the way it went when you were a centre half, so you accepted all that.
I remember that they cheered every time I got the ball for the next 3 or 4 minutes, and that was the start, I think. I just knew they were with me, they were going to stay with me.
I don't know who made this song, but it's a little bit funny because it's saying I came from near, from Moscow, which is further from Czech Republic to Moscow than from to England. I think they like it.
They can cut you in half with one cutting remark when they feel like it, and but when they're with you, there's nowhere better.
And then if somebody else started giving us stick, they'd turn the other way and you know, they'd want to defend us.
If you're looking for reasons why you want to stay at this place and not move on to the Olympic Stadium, you might talk about the Chicken Run because of the intimacy of it, the closeness of the fans to the players.
The fans could touch you on the back when you're taking a throw in. I mean, people offered you sweets and everything else.
So I ball boyed on that Chicken Run, and I think I was about 14 at the time, and I never forget, the ball went out near me and I wasn't even looking. The fans were hammering me from behind because I was losing. I didn't chuck the ball in quick enough, and then I sort of realised what the Chicken Run was about.
In the early days when I was a struggling and mediocre midfield player, my wife used to get quite irritated, and when people made an objectionable comment to me, she threw peanuts at them.
This ground is scary, emotional, passionate. It was like a suffocating feeling. Everyone was right on top of you. The language wasn't choice. A lot of dockers over there. And I can still see the veins popping out their necks trying to get to me. John Lyle's team of 86 was a fantastic team. He brought a couple of players in, McAvenny and Mark Ward, who shook everything up.
Devonshire's in a lot of space on the right. Ward! Oh, a tremendous goal! Mark Ward! Cotty now. Cotty! West Ham in the lead!
We had probably the best strike force I ever saw, which was Frank McAvenny and Tony Cotty playing together. And what a pairing they were. So many great goals between them.
Cotty to McAvenny. Well, would you believe it? That's four.
There was only one way we were ever going to play, and that was to entertain. Big teams. Liverpool, Manchester United players. Fans were right on top of them, and it was scary. And these were players who'd played in massive stadiums all over the world. They did not like playing here.
I made my debut on the same day that Avi Martin made his last appearance for the club.
And you know that he is the next thing, and he is going to take your place.
That's the type of fairy tale you kind of write, if you could, him passing the baton over to me.
And I seen a kid in training. I played a couple of reserve games with him, and I thought, wow, he's going to be some player. Goodbye, Alvin Martin.
There was a big expectations on my shoulders coming into the first team, and I came out against Sheffield Wednesday. I remember the ball was bouncing about, and everyone knew me as this ball-playing centre-half who was good on the ball and liked to take people on and stuff. And my first touch, I smashed it into Rose Ed. And it was almost like a bit of a... Is that really him? Is that the right one we've got here? Kind of thing. It felt like that in the stadium, a bit of a chuckle and stuff from people. And I actually had a little laugh myself to my inside, really, thinking that's not really what they expected. But
and I played a reserve game at Highbury with Rio when Ian Wright was playing for Arsenal in reserves. Rio did not give Wright a kick. And I sat on the coach going to the next first team game, and Harry said to me, "How did Rio play?" I said, "Harry, he's going to be some player." He was.
When the academy put out a fabulous first team for us, which included Rio Ferdinand, Joe Cole, young Frank Lampard, Harry Redknapp in charge, it was a fabulous time to be watching West Ham.
I used to clean the away dressing room, and I remember poking my head around the corner, one of the doors one time. We played United, and they all turned around and said, "What do you want?" I said, "Look, do you mind if I come in and start cleaning up?" Because bearing in mind, I had to get about four different tubes home and then buses to get home. And it was a midweek game. And I was thinking, I'm going to be well late. I'm going to miss my, the trains are going to stop. And I just got absolutely shouted out of the room, like, "Know your place." I used to come and watch as a youth team player, as a schoolboy, and watch the games, dagging the motors on the jersey. All loads of players. I was thinking I'd love to be like him one day, the Alvin Martins, the Steve Pottses, the Dixies. Dixie used to just like never warm up. Used to warming up was part and parcel of being a footballer. You've got to warm up before you strike the balls, etc. Dixie just go in the bath, read the programme.
A hot bath with two cans of Coke and a Mars bar.
Nowadays you've got a hot bath before a game and they look at you like you're a lunatic. They probably won't let you play.
If I was lucky, I didn't have to warm up. I could just go out at 5-3, just start smashing balls about.
Here comes Dixon, that's a shooting opportunity. And what a shooting opportunity! Julian Dix picked that one out.
Any crowd had become used to a standard of football, but I think probably our crowd are used to probably the highest standard of football of all.
Hurst to Redknapp! Oh, what a goal! Oh, what a fantastic goal by Redknapp!
send Collins one way, then the other, and curling one! Oh, wonderful goal by Trevor Brooking!
Thoughtful, make it pass us prone.
To Peters, to Brooking.
Keep the football and play with style.
Good play by Mignan! Oh, what a beautiful bit of football!
People come into this ground to be entertained. They want to win. They want to win as fiercely as the players do. But they want to be entertained.
I couldn't imagine during the game to try and shoot and a volleyball in this technique. There was a fantastic ball, a typical English ball from Trevor Sinclair. In less than a second, I decided to kick this ball with a bicycle volley with both feet off the ground. I made, in my opinion, one of the best and perfect shoot on goal, one of the best ever.
Paolo was an amazing footballer. I said to the chairman at the time, Terry Brown, I want to sign Paolo Di Canio. And that was after he'd pushed Mr. Alcott over, you know, the referee, and he went, no, anyone but him, anyone. He held his head, he put his head in his hands, and I said, he's different class, I think they'll love him here, you know. He gets you off your seat. They're the type of people I enjoy watching, someone who can beat someone and do something special. They can change your game for you, and he was a game changer. A little bit like the boy they got now, Paya, you know, someone who can do something special, change the game for you, a flash of genius.
I used to sneak in Upton Park and try and get him without a ticket when I was really young. I'll never forget, I was 16, I think, 16, nearly turned 17, and one of the scouts come up in the stand and said, Mark, you're travelling with the first team tomorrow. I'm the first one to say I'm not the best player in the world, or I ain't a Steven Gerrard or a player like that, but I've played under every single manager that's come to the club. And started every season, so that's a proud thing for me. It was so important because we was in the relegation fight. I was playing holding midfield that game, and I don't know why I ended up where I did. It come off my foot and I caught it sweet. I'll never forget Teddy said to me after, Teddy Sheringham was in the squad at the time, I was playing with him, and he said to me after, when it come across, what was you thinking? I said, to be honest, Ted, I just wanted to hit as hard as I could towards a goal. But he said, you didn't try and pick a corner in that. And obviously, he was a lot more experienced at scoring goals than I was. And that always stuck with me. That's why, obviously, he scored so many amazing goals, because he thought about where he was putting it, when he, instead of just smashing it like I did. That sort of kick-started our run of games to stay in the Premier League that year, that great escape. We got a great reception from the crowd. We lost 4-3, and I cried at the end of the game because we lost. It was just the emotional roller coaster, and I cared so much and wanted to keep the club in the Premier League, and just couldn't help myself but to get emotional. And you're winning, and the crowd are behind you, and you make a tackle, and everyone goes mad over it. It's just amazing.
You come out and you hear that crowd and it lifts you. It does. It genuinely lifts you. You think, Christ, you know, we've got to do this tonight. The Spurs game the other night, you knew the crowd were up for it. It was a big game for us, you know. It was against Spurs, who, you know, aren't our favourite people. And you sense, the players sense that. I said to Slaven, you've put a lot of spirit into this club. The one thing I said that stands out for me this season is the team spirit.
You bring players in and they go out, and you bring other players in. And he said, it's always been there. And I think that's a very, very good analogy of it. I think it has always been there. It's sort of the spirit of this football club has always been there, and it's it comes from the crowd.
One of the great things about grounds like the Boleyn Ground is that they're right set in the middle of a community. They are in the middle of the back streets. It's sort of cheap by jowl existence, which gives you that kind of intimacy. People live and work and breathe all around this ground 7 days a week. So many people would have grown up here. They're going to miss it.
I'm sad, but I'm 70 years old this year, and progress has to, there's a word called progress.
To be honest, I was gutted. I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. I was gutted. But the Olympic Stadium is half as good as Upton Park, and it'd be a fantastic place to play football.
The fans will look on it with remorse, but they will understand that if the reasons are good why they're leaving, then they'll go with the club.
I think they'll feel it. They'll feel it. I think people say, well, they will get the crowds.
It'll create its own history. It takes time.
Better players are going to want to come and play there. More people are going to go and watch football there.
And maybe, who knows, West Ham might have a chance of winning the league one day.
It's going to push this club to the next level, I think.
I can still imagine me playing games. That comes back, like the vision comes back where I played.
I look upon this ground, this club, simply as my home.
Been a massive part of my life, leaving school just before my 15th birthday and going there. So yeah, I grew up there.
I would say to any supporter, it's your club. Follow your club wherever it goes.
What's in store today? We could be brilliant, beat anyone, and we could be hopeless and lose to anyone. So I wonder what's in store today.
Blimey, where have the last 38 years gone? Any player that walks out onto this pitch in front of these supporters instantly has their respect.
For me, it was the best 11 years of my life. It was out of this world.
West Ham always will stay in my heart, and that will be my number one club forever.
I'm forever blowing bubbles on the tannoys, coming out of speakers, the chicken run. They're things that will never leave you. Talking about old times and will you come back, etc. So watch this space.
It's a sort of a religion. It's not only a football team, because it was like a cathedral for me.
I've been so lucky. I'm going to be the last ever captain to lead a team out at Upton Park, you know, and I don't sort of want it to end.